Okay, welcome everybody to the course on Introduction to Topological Field Theory. So my name is Marcos Marino, and I'm going to give you my email in case you want to ask questions about the course or fix an appointment. So let me make some general comments on the course. This is a delicate course because topological quantum field theory, as its name indicates, is a special type of quantum field theory. So in principle, in order to really understand topological quantum field theory, you should first have a very good understanding of quantum field theory, which is I suppose not the case for everybody here, okay? But that's not, in principle, a big obstruction, because topological quantum field theories turn out to be very simple quantum field theory. So in a sense, you don't need the full paraphernalia of quantum field theory in order to understand topological quantum field theories. Okay? So that's one positive aspect of this. Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of the subject is a mixing between physics and mathematics. So there is like a common background that it will be good if you have it. So in terms of physics, the only thing that I will really ask for you is to have some knowledge of classical mechanics and of quantum mechanics, okay? And I think you have taken courses on both at some point. But of course, you know, you cannot really pretend to do a course on topological field theory if you don't know any physics. I mean, that would be very hard. One could possibly hook up a course like this, but it would be very hard. In any case, don't be discouraged if your physics background is not enough, because with some effort you should be able to follow the course. I mean, I'm going to try to keep the physics requirements to the minimum, okay? Now, in terms of mathematics, I will assume some knowledge of differential forms, differential manifolds, and vector bundles. Again, there are some more sophisticated aspects of mathematics that you might need in the course, like, for example, the theory of characteristic classes, but if you don't know it, again, it's fine. I mean, you should be able to survive. You have to take into account that topological quantum field theory is a very advanced topic, in a sense. So this is really an experiment to see if we can really make a course. I think a master class on this topic is really an experiment, but we'll see how it goes. Okay? And so you will learn something about it. Okay? Now, in terms of the style, the course will be more like a physics course than a mathematics course. So there will be some formal statements like lemma, theorem, and so on, but not necessarily all the course will be fit into that framework, okay? So for those of you who come from a physics background, this is, you know, this is a normal thing. For those of you who have a mathematical background, I think also part of the main point of having a master class like this is to learn not only the contents, but also the style of work of the other side. So if you're a mathematician, it's good to learn how the physicists work. And and vice versa, you know, if you're a math physicist, it's good to know, and you're interested in mathematical physics, you have to be, you have to get used to how mathematicians work. So for physicists, this means that you have to, at some point, you have to use rigor, and you have to, you know, to be more careful. And for mathematicians, just the opposite. This means I have to relax a little bit, okay? You know, when you're in a course in physics, you know, and everything is not, you know, things are not completely well-defined, and you have to relax, okay? It's quite surprising that people who are already as young as you know, some of you are already so much into the mathematical language that, you know, it takes really a hard time to relax, but you should learn to relax, okay? So it's actually very important, because if you are interested in mathematical physics, at some point you will have to read papers by physicists, and if you don't relax, you will be very frustrated. So, you know, physics is more like an exploratory thing, okay, in which things are a little bit fuzzier, less well-defined, but you should just go with the flow and, you know, and don't panic, okay? So this is also important, and that's why, you know, part of the course will be in that style, okay? There will be some point theorems and definitions and so on, but this is not going to be a very formal course. I think you have already taken most of the courses you have in this master class are very formal, so it's not going to hurt you to have like a less formal course, okay? Very good. Now, so there will be theory and exercises. Also, in such an advanced course, it's not so easy to distinguish both. And this week and the next week, I will be teaching theory for all the time, because in order to do the exercise, we need some sort of basic background, and then, you know, I will have to, this week I really need to teach the 3 hours in order to kind of give you enough background to do the exercises. And next week, the assistant of the exercise is not going to be in Geneva, so I will also going to teach. But don't worry, there will be catching up later on in such a way that you don't have an overdose of theory or an overdose of exercise, okay? So at some point, the assistant will actually teach. So instead of having 2 hours of theory and 1 hour of exercise, you will have 2 hours of exercise and 1 hour of theory in some weeks. But this is going to be just for the very beginning, because we really need, I mean, it's, you know, already if I want to give some introduction and so on, I won't have enough time, you won't have enough time today to do really the exercise, because to do the exercise you need to have some background. Okay, so like more practical things, and writing some notes on the course, some LaTeX notes. So for the moment being, they are not available, but they will be available, okay? So if you want, I can give you the notes like by, I can give you the few chapters. I haven't written the whole course yet, but I have written maybe 1/3 of the course already. So if you want, I can create a Moodle space of the course in which you can download the first 3rd part of the course, and then, you know, later on I will have others and also the exercises, okay? So I haven't done it yet, but the notes are already written down. I also, my computer essentially crashed a couple of days ago, so it was not easy to me to create this Moodle space, but the notes are written, so I will probably put them, at least the first part there. So you can, so if you are not able to come to the course one day, don't worry, there will be LaTeX notes for this, okay, and also exercises. Now, in terms of bibliography, there are various references at the end of these notes. Maybe I'm going to write for you. So as I said, it's not so easy to teach a course like this. And if you look around, there are not that many books. There is a book that I like very much, which is slightly, I mean, it's not really on topological field theory. It's called Mirror Symmetry. It's and this book, it's the spirit of the book is very similar to the spirit of the course. So actually, it's a very good book. It's a very thick book, and it's really a book on mirror symmetry, which is in a sense one aspect of topological field theory, is one particular type of topological field theory, but it has very good introductory chapters, and I have followed a little bit the spirit. Then there are more like advanced references that you will find. I actually wrote a book on topological field theory and 4 manifolds long ago, so some parts of it I will also use. So there are, but if you have any particular doubt or you have any particular request, you just ask me and we'll try to direct you to the most, to a more precise reference. But if you want to have like a general reference on the course, this this book on mirror symmetry is quite good, okay? Okay, and then, you know, concerning the exam, so there will be a written exam. The point of the exam is just, I mean, I think in advanced course there is no, doesn't make much sense to like make very complicated exams, so the exam will be simple, so just to, you have a basic understanding of the course, you should be able to pass, okay? So don't panic about that, because that should be easy, okay? So are there any questions on the technical aspects of the exam? No? Okay. Okay, so so what are topological quantum field theories? What is, so let me give you maybe a little bit an overview of the subject and the history of the subject. So so let me ask you, actually first ask you about you. Among you, who have taken courses on quantum field theory? Okay, you two, okay? 3 persons, okay? Okay, but everybody else has taken at least a course on quantum mechanics, right? Yes, everybody, okay, good. Okay, so topological quantum field theories, as I said before, are special types of quantum field theories. So essentially, you know, quantum field theories describe interacting quantum fields, like for example, you know, the quantum fields that make out our physical world are the quantum field theory is based on quantum electrodynamics, quantum chromodynamics, and so on. So it's like a kind of far-reaching generalization of quantum mechanics. And essentially, quantum field theory is the kind of thing that people, for example, study in the particle accelerator at CERN. So usually, you know, when you do particle physics, you assume that you work on a Euclidean or a Minkowski space on an R4, okay, with signature Minkowskian or Euclidean, depending on what you want to do. And then you study the properties of these quantum field theories in a completely trivial manifold, R4. Now, people realized already long ago that you can study quantum field theories, you can study these particles that interact on an arbitrary manifold. Okay, you can put these theories on, say, a forest sphere or your more complicated, your favorite four manifold. And when you do that, the type of manifold that you use will actually change the types of the way that the particles interact. So properties of the quantum field theory will depend on the manifold. And in particular, if you want to define quantum field theory on an arbitrary manifold, you will have to use a Riemannian metric. Okay? You need a Riemannian metric of your manifold to define your quantum field theory. Okay? That you can see already when you write the action principle for most quantum field theories, you have to use an action, a metric. Now, so this means that everything that you compute will depend on the metric of the manifold. If you change the Riemannian metric, the properties of the theory will be different. Now, it was a sort of surprise when in the late 80s, early 90s, people found that there are some very special types of quantum field theories for which at least some of the things that you calculate do not depend on the Riemannian metric on the manifold that you're using. Okay? And it turns out that many quantities that you calculate in these theories are called topological quantum field theories because they do not really depend on the metric on the manifold that you're working on. Okay? And that's quite surprising, but if you have some background in mathematics, this is not so surprising because in mathematics it's normal that you use metric information. You use something that in principle depends on the metric, but at the end of the day you obtain a result which is metric independent. And the most important example, maybe, is the Gauss theorem to calculate the curvature of a three-manifold. You can calculate the curvature of a three-manifold by using the Riemannian metric, but you know that the result of the integral of the curvature of the three-manifold is a surface. I mean, you can formulate the Gauss theorem in various dimensions. You actually get something that does not depend on the metric, but is really a topological characteristic of the manifold. So this is something that, for example, in the theory of characteristic classes, you do all the time. And one of the things that we will do in the course, we will revisit the theory of characteristic classes in the language of quantum field theory. So you will see how the independence with respect to the metric of characteristic classes of bundles actually fits also into this framework. So quantum field theories then topological field theories are quantum field theories that you formulate on an arbitrary manifold. In many cases, you have to choose a metric, Riemannian metric on the manifold to define the theory, but at least some of the quantities that you calculate turn out to be independent of the metric of the manifold and only depend on the differentiable structure of the manifold. Okay? And that's the first thing. The second important ingredient is that it turns out that these topological quantum field theories turn out to be equivalent to theories that were introduced by mathematicians. So, for example, the first quantum field theory was introduced by Witten. It's a complicated quantum field theory. I don't know if you are going to have the time to study it here, but it turns out to be equivalent to the theory of Donaldson invariance of four manifolds. Okay? So these theories are not only surprising because they do not depend on, you know, also you start with a quantum field theory, at the end of the day, many of the aspects of this theory does not depend on the metric on the manifold that you are working on. And at the end of the day, you also see that these theories are actually equivalent to interesting mathematical theories. Okay? And interesting and very difficult to understand mathematical theories. So topological quantum theories give you the possibility to study the geometry, the topology of manifolds using techniques in quantum field theory. Okay? Now, I have to say that most of the kind of spectacular results in topological quantum field theory have been obtained by using really ideas from physics. what happens is that physicists for 100 years almost have been studying quantum field theories, and they have a very fantastic toolbox to analyze these theories, and sometimes the techniques that physicists use to analyze these theories are essentially not well understood mathematically and are not used by mathematicians, and then using these tools you can get results that mathematicians must have a much harder time to obtain. Okay? So if we're really interested in understanding topological quantum field theories and to get really new results, we would really need to go through understanding quantum field theory in more detail. Okay? So that would be a different course. This is a course which is an introductory course, so it will be different. Yes?
Is there also some benefit in the other direction, that through studying field theories and arbitrary manifolds, we can understand QFTs better in physics?
Yes. That's the case. That's I think also the case. But the impact of that thing has been much smaller, I would say. I mean, it's clear that if you want to understand some aspects of quantum field theory working on a general manifold, it's a very good idea in some cases. But I think if you ask quantum field theories what has been the impact of this way of thinking into quantum field theory in general, probably she would tell you that, you know, it hasn't been so big. But if you tell many mathematicians, you know, what has been the impact of the ideas of physics on quantum, on this, for example, on the theory of Donaldson invariance, has been enormous. I mean, essentially, the theory of Donaldson invariance, for example, for which Donaldson got the Fields Medal in the late 80s, essentially, the whole theory got completely reformulated because of the impact of topological quantum field theory. Essentially, the Donaldson invariance turned out to be very complicated, and then people forgot about them and introduced a new set of invariants, which were called the Cyber-Wooten invariants. And these Cyber-Wooten invariants were completely motivated by the quantum field theory approach to Donaldson invariance. So, and this was like a huge revolution in four-manifold topology. So this was really like, essentially, the whole field of four-manifold topology changed completely because of the impact of physics. So this kind of really like complete revolution in a mathematical field that quantum field theory had, I don't think has a counterpart in the opposite direction that you're mentioning. But of course, it's also important. So you really have a point there. Okay. Okay. So that's one of the motivations. And as I said, if you want to be really a good quantum field theorist, you have to really combine both insights from mathematics and from physics. Okay. But as I said, what we're going to do in this course is much more elementary. We're going to kind of more or less set the stage. And study kind of some simple examples. Okay, actually, many of the examples we are going to do are going to be really kind of based on quantum mechanics in one dimension or even in zero dimensions. So I'm going to study zero dimensions, which is always very good because zero dimensions is just a point. So you live in a point; it's a very easy life. Okay, it's very simple, and we are going to start with that. Okay, so any question, comment? Okay, so let's start then with the first thing. So as I said, we want to start with something very simple. So I'm going to start by doing quantum field theory in zero dimensions. So quantum field theories depends on the dimension. So you live in a zero-dimensional manifold, in one-dimensional manifold, or in two-dimensional manifold. So we are going to start with quantum field theory in zero dimensions. Okay. So what does it mean? Well, you know, in general, a quantum field is typically a function. I mean, here, as I said, I'm not going to be very general because there is no general definition of what S. But if you think of a quantum field on a manifold, so you can think about a function. The basic model for a quantum field of a manifold is just a function, okay, from this manifold M, okay, and with values in R or in other, typically on R or on Rn or so on. But you know, this is kind of the simplest example of what is a quantum field. Just a function that takes values on your manifold and has values in R. Now, If your manifold is zero-dimensional, this means that the only thing you have, you know, if your manifold is zero-dimensional, so this is a point, and essentially you just don't have a function, you just have a variable. So here, you know, the quantum field becomes just a standard variable, okay? And so, essentially, you don't have really fields, you don't have functions on a manifold, you just have variables with values in R, okay? So this is, in a sense, the simplest thing you have to do, okay? Now, when you do a quantum field theory, so this is a quantum field. Now, you know quantum field theory, there is a kind of a standard approach that I don't know if you are familiar with, which is to start with an axiom. You start with an axiom functional. And this is the same thing that you have in quantum in classical mechanics. So classical mechanics is based on axiom functional. So if you are in a general framework, in a quantum field theory, in a manifold M, your axiom is an axiom is a functional of functions. Okay, so given a function or a manifold, you get you get the value of the axiom, which I'm going to take to be real. So if you want, S is a map. The axiom functional is a map from the space of functions into R, okay? And so you have a function X, this will give me the value of this axiom function on X. So if you have done classical mechanics, this is what you do with the axiom principle of classical mechanics. Now in zero dimensions, this is much simpler because what you have to do, I mean, here they are not functions, but are just variables. So the axiom functional is just a standard function of X. So the axiom functional is really a function of variable X, so which are going to assume that this is smooth and differentiable and so on. And essentially, any function of a variable X gives me a quantum field theory in zero dimensions. Okay? Any function of zero of a variable X gives me such an axiom function in zero dimensions. So in a sense, the world of quantum field theory in zero dimensions can be regarded as the classical level as just the world of functions of a single of a variable, okay, or of various variables. Okay? Because this can be generalized. So these are, I'm introducing some heuristics here. This is not really, I mean, if you are not completely convinced about what I'm not being sufficiently precise here, probably for those of you especially with more mathematical standards. But don't worry, this is like more like a justification of how you do quantum field theories in zero dimensions based on ideas of physics, okay? So as I said, the important thing is that in zero dimensions you don't have fields, you just have variables, and you don't have functionals, you just have functions, okay? Functionals become functions, okay? So this is a much simpler world to work on, okay? Now, if you are familiar with the path integral formulation of quantum mechanics, I don't know if you are familiar. Are you familiar with the path integral formulation of quantum mechanics, all of you? Or more or less, you have heard about it, okay? Now, in quantum mechanics, once you have an axiom functional, you know, in quantum mechanics, in quantum field theory, quantum mechanics in general, so in quantum field theory, you have to do this kind of very mysterious thing, which is the path integral, in which you do some sort of integration over the space of fields, and then you integrate a function of the field like this. Okay? So this is this path integral. I'm not going to use this in the course, okay? Probably. So, but you see, this is really a very special thing because your variable of integration is itself a function on a manifold, okay? So defining the measure for this is very complicated and so on. But what is the advantage of doing quantum field theory in zero dimensions? Well, the good thing about doing quantum field theory in zero dimensions is that this, as I said, is no longer a function on the manifold, but it's just a variable. So And this is not a functional of a function, but it's just a function of a variable. So path integrals in zero dimensions become ordinary integrals, okay? So in zero dimensions, all this headache about path integrals and what is the measure of the path integral are completely trivial because these are ordinary integrals. So in a sense, you can think about ordinary integration of functions, which is a subject that I guess is known to many of you. Ordinary integration of functions is exactly quantum field theory in zero dimensions. So in zero dimensions, quantum field theory becomes really very simple because it's just a branch of classical analysis, it's just a branch of classical integration theory, okay? So this is why we are going to, okay? This is why we are going to work in zero dimensions to start with, okay? So let me then give you some sort of the, so let me recapitulate. What are the ingredients for quantum field theory in zero dimensions? So we have variables. I mean, I just introduced one there, but of course, you know. So this is I'm going to denote by a vector. So we are going to take these variables to be a vector in RP. You have a function, a functional, or function S from RP in R, which is called the action. So these are the fields. So the action is just a function from RP to R. In some cases, we will have to make some restrictions of the type of action that we want to do. And then we have the quantities to calculate. And so the first thing we are going to introduce is a very important quantity, which is called the partition function. So this is a function. I'm going to introduce a variable h bar, okay, which is a real parameter. Okay, so here h bar is a real parameter. And positive, okay, so it's a positive real number. And once you are given this set of variables and this function, I'm going to define this as the integration of e to the minus 1 over h bar of s of x, okay? So this quantity is sometimes called the partition function in physics. And for those of you who are familiar with quantum mechanics, this is just mimicking standard quantum theory, quantum mechanics in zero dimensions, okay? But in a language that everybody knows. This is just a conventional integral. This h bar is a parameter which plays the role of h bar in quantum theory. So this is supposed to be a very small quantity, okay, in some sense. Mm. And this is the partition function that you want to compute, okay? Now, one way to think about that, so the partition function, one way to think about all this framework, so equivalent way, is that you can think about this, dx times e to the minus h bar sx, as a probability distribution. Okay? You can think about as a probability density. Okay? So you can think about this as a probability distribution. Of course, for this you need some sort of positivity properties, but I will come to this later on. And then if you have the partition function, then is the total integral of this probability distribution. We are not normalizing this. This is not necessarily one, okay? We are not normalizing it. But this happens very often in life, that you have a probability distribution that is not normalized. But what you want to calculate when you have a probability distribution that is not normalized are normalized expectation values. So given And this is another of the quantities to calculate given an arbitrary function. F RP with values in R, we want to calculate another quantity that you want to calculate in a quantum theory is the average of this function. And this is 1 over z of h bar times the integral of dx e to the minus s of x divided by h bar times f of x. Okay? From the point of view of probability theory, this is completely natural, because if this is a probability distribution, this is the average of this function with this probability distribution, and since this total integral is not necessarily normalized to unity, you have to divide by them. Okay? So this is another quantity that we want to calculate, and this is called a vacuum expectation value sometimes, or a correlation function, whatever, it has many names. Okay? So this is the framework in which we are going to start. We're going to start then with a kind of very toy model of quantum field theory. So we go to zero dimensions, and then suddenly you realize that just by having taken courses on calculus, you are able to do quantum field theory in zero dimensions. So this should be a kind of very good news to those mathematicians who have not studied quantum field theory. In a sense, they knew some quantum field theory just in zero dimensions, but that one they knew, okay? And we are now going to elaborate. Of course, the kind of techniques that people use in quantum field theory are very specific, and the kind of questions that you want to ask are very specific, but essentially quantum field theory in zero dimensions is not very different from doing integrals or different from studying probability distributions and so on. Okay? Now, if you don't, so for those of you who have some idea of physics, the only thing I have done here is transposing complicated things in general quantum theory in some things which are very simple and which we can actually make some progress. Okay? Is that okay? Have any questions about this? So we are going to start doing these kind of things. And for those of you who might think that this is going to be, you know, too simple or too trivial, there is a very slight modification of quantum physics in zero dimensions, which essentially is called the theory of random matrix. And I think you have half courses on random matrices here. So random matrix theory is actually a special case of quantum field theory in zero dimensions. Okay? And I will actually show you how this goes, okay? So this is another point of view on the theory of random matrices, but you see in random matrices what you have. You have a probability distribution in the space of matrices, right? And then you study averages of quantities in the functions of these matrices, and that's essentially it, right? This is what is random matrix theory. But you see, we are actually studying probability distributions. Random matrices are what? Are variables, but instead of being single numbers, they are matrices. So I could now define this theory, instead of having X to be a vector, I could define X to be a matrix, and this would be a random matrix theory. Okay? So many of the properties that you actually study in random matrix theory can be very usefully studied in the context of quantum field in zero dimensions. Okay? So for example, have you taken all of you have taken this course on random matrices? So for example, you have studied the Wigner distribution, the semicircle distribution of Wigner. This can be derived using quantum field theory methods, for example. It's actually the saddle point approximation to this integral. Okay? So probably you will do it in the exercises. So what I mean is that don't be depressed because, you know, you wanted to learn quantum field theory, you get here, you know, we're doing zero dimensions, so you think that, you know, this is too simple, okay? Maybe I want to learn it, but what is the use of it? But don't worry, you know, it's sufficiently big, quantum field theory in zero dimensions, to include already two courses that you have taken, okay? Very good. So, So now, a very important difference between mathematicians and physicists is that physicists really want to do calculations. You see? They really have to do calculations. I mean, you know, just existence, uniqueness and existence are not enough, okay? I mean, you don't, you know, knowing that something exists that is unique, you know, can, maybe it's a consolation for some souls, but not for all of souls. And, you know, some people really want to know what is this, what is exists and is unique, right? So what I'm going to do now is to actually explain a little bit how you do calculations here, okay? Because that's, you see, I don't know, in, so here, as an integration is on RP. So, you know, the key thing is to actually calculate this quantity. So this is things that you want to calculate, okay? Now, of course, you know, what you want to calculate depends very much on the main data here. The main data here is this function which I call the action. So you want to calculate these integrals, everything depends on the action, okay? Now, it turns out that, so let me give you an example, which is going to be a model. This example is, in a sense, the simplest quantum, non-trivial quantum field theory. Well, there are actually two examples. So let me give you an example one. Now, if you have, let me give you an example one. This is as simple as it can be. So I'm going to work in one dimension, okay? And if you think about probability distributions in the form of an exponential, there is a sort of obvious guess of what is the simple one. What is the simplest probability distribution in exponential form? The Gaussian, right? So the Gaussian plays a crucial role in quantum theory, okay? And this is because the Gaussian theory corresponds to what is called a free theory in quantum physics, okay? So, but let me first tell you what is the simplest case. So the simplest case is this. So I'm going to call this the Gaussian theory. So as I said, this is the Gaussian theory. It's a quantum field theory of dimensions. Okay. And then, you know, of course, you know, here everything is easy, right? I mean, you want to calculate set of H, right? This is the integral over R of e to the minus 1 over 2H x squared dx. And, you know, this integral, it's a very important integral to compute. Right? I guess everybody knows how to compute it. And the result of this integral, if I don't mistake, is this, okay? So that's the simplest. So you see, the partition function of a Gaussian theory is trivial to compute in zero dimensions. It's just this Gaussian integral. Now, you could now ask about how to calculate correlation functions. Correlation functions are not so simple because these are averages of general functions in a Gaussian, with a Gaussian probability distribution, right? But, you know, I'm going to actually address this question in a more systematic way later on because I'm going to prove what is called Wick's lemma, which Wick's lemma is essentially a systematic way of doing these calculations. But in principle, it's something that you shouldn't be worried about. You know how to calculate, for example, averages of monomials in a Gaussian distribution, right? I mean, these are things that are easy to calculate, okay? So this theory is easy. Again, for those of you who are interested in the connection to physics, why this theory is easy, because it corresponds to what is called in classical quantum theory, a free theory. So you know, usually you have a Hamiltonian, which is quadratic, something like this. So this is a quadratic Hamiltonian, and this is something that this is the harmonic oscillator. So this is something that you know how to solve, right? You know how to solve. This is the harmonic oscillator, and this is one of the few exactly solvable models of quantum mechanics. And essentially, the Gaussian theory in zero dimensions that I just showed you is the zero-dimensional counterpart of this type of harmonic oscillator theory, okay? Very good, so now let's pass to a more complicated example. So this is the analog of this. I mean, explaining this in more detail, you know, it probably takes some time, but you do the, essentially, when you do the path integral formulation of the harmonic oscillator, you can see that it's just a bunch of Gaussian integrals like this. Okay? This is something that is known for people have some benefits. But you see, essentially, you see, this is variables here only appear quadratical, and this is what this make life simple. I mean, you have x squared, you know, this is very simple. You know how to do these things. Okay? Now, let's do something slightly more complicated. So we keep a real variable, but now I'm going to add something to this. I'm going to add something to this integral. So I'm going to add a fourth order term. Okay. So instead of having a quadratic polynomial, I will have a quartic polynomial. Now, when you have this, now you have to calculate set of h bar, and then you have the integral over r of e to the minus 1 over h bar, and then I have this. And then I said, okay, let's calculate this. I mean, I guess most of you will be in trouble, right? I mean, this is not something that you learn in kindergarten, right? How to do this integral, right? You don't know how to do it. Now, in order to express it in a nicer way, or in a way that is useful, let me actually change variables and put, so here you see h bar is in front of the function. But I can just change variables, so I do this change of variables, x to the h 1 half x, and it's very easy to see that this integral becomes e to the, well, it has an h bar to the half, that comes from the change of, from the integration measure. And then what you have here is this. So this is just a trivial change of variables, okay? And now it's very interesting if you think about this integral, because you see, this is again where physics intuition is useful. So what is physics intuition telling you? Well, you want to calculate this integral. So actually this integral can be calculated in terms of special functions. Okay? So in one dimension, this still can be done. But this is maybe not the best approach to this, because you know, I mean, you want to have some kind of general way of approaching these sort of quantities, which is not based on the fact that you will find the right special function when you look at them. You want to have some sort of general approach. So the general approach to this is based on the following idea. You know that h bar, you know, this is something that everybody, I guess, knows. H bar is small, right? It should be a small quantity, right? Shouldn't be, you know, h bar is, in real life, is a small quantity. So you know that when you have small quantities, you can try to do a perturbative approach. So perturbative means that if you put this quantity to zero, you put h bar to zero, modulo this factor here, but you know that this integral can be computed easily, right? If you put h bar to zero, okay? So since we know how to solve the problem when h bar is equal to zero, let's try to get a way of solving this problem with h bar is small. And this framework to do this is perturbation theory. It's called perturbation theory. So we are going to think about this problem as some problem that we can solve plus a small perturbation that we cannot solve. Okay? And again, this is a very physical way of looking at things. Of course, there is a kind of very rich mathematical theory of perturbation theory. We could discuss about this as well. But I want really you to get some the insight of physicists when they look at this type of problems. Okay? They say, well, this is the model that we know how to solve. This model I don't know how to solve, but let's think about this as a small perturbation of something that I know how to solve. Okay? Yes?
In this particular case, we want h bar to be small with respect to what?
Yes, that's a very good question. Here I'm not worried about units and so on, so let's take h bar as a small, as a formal small variable, okay? So here, so it's true that in general saying that something is small and something with dimensions cannot be really small, because only a non-dimensional, a dimensional quantities are really small. But here we are going to, for the moment, we are not going to really worry about that. Let's work about this as a, just as a formal, as a formal, as a formal variable. Okay. So, and I cannot really overstate the importance of perturbation theory in physics. Okay. Really, it's kind of the tool to actually solve problems in quantum theory. And that's how people actually solve problems in most of the cases. I mean, if you don't know how to do this integral, you still want to say something about it, and the way to say something about it is called perturbation theory. Okay. And what we are going to do in the next courses, we are going to develop the formal theory of perturbation theory of these general Gauss integrals, which are perturbations of a Gaussian. And essentially, this is something that you can formalize very easily. And with this, you have already all the skeleton of perturbation theory in quantum theory. I mean, now you open a book on quantum field theory, essentially what you're going to find there is pretty much what I'm telling you here. They will work in arbitrary dimensions, and they will look more complicated, but the formal structure is the same. So that's why, also, this is not really, strictly speaking, topological field theory. I mean, it's really the basics of quantum field theory. So for those of you who are not familiar with the basics of quantum field theory, after learning about this, you will have really half of the steps made in order to understand actual quantum field theory calculations. So let's start with this kind of very simple example. So what you do here? Well, now here is where essentially physicists and mathematicians differ very much, okay, in the way of thinking. So what a physicist would do? Well, a physicist would say, well, okay, this is small, great, because I know something which is called a Taylor expansion. So I can Taylor expand this function, and I know that this will give me. So I have 1 over n factorial minus h over 4 to the n and x to the 4 n, right? So this is actually true. This is a convergent series. This is a convergent Taylor expansion of this exponential, which is valid for any h bar and for anything, OK? So now you say, well, let me not put any sign here, but let's actually write this as n equals 0 to infinity. So I just expand inside the integral, okay? I expand the integrand, and then, you know, I'm going to exchange integration with sum, and then what I get here, I get x to the 4 n dx, and then I get this is multiplied by 1 over n factorial minus h bar over. Okay. Now here I didn't write. So here what I did was to take the expansion of this. This gives me a sum. I exchange the sum with the integral, and I get this. And I get this quantity here. Now, of course, the reason why I didn't put an equal here is because this operation is not really is not allowed mathematically. You cannot exchange an infinite sum with an integral unless some very restrictive properties are verified, right? Now, actually, in this case, these properties are not verified, so it's not true that this is equal to this. And also, this series is convergent. This is a convergence expansion of the exponential function. This series here is not going to be convergent. So we don't really, while doing this, we don't really get a convergent series. But, you know, that's, again, you know, that's something that physicists do not really worry about. So what this happens is that this series that I'm going to obtain here is an asymptotic expansion. Of the original integral. So it's a little bit like this, this approximation to the gamma function that you probably have used many times, right? So what's the name of this approximation? Stirling approximation to the gamma function. So this is not really a convergent series, it's an asymptotic series, but it's an asymptotic representation when h is very small of this original integral. Okay? So you will actually do, in the exercises, I'm not going to elaborate on this here now because I'm more interested on the formal aspects of how do you construct this sort of series, but in the exercises you will really look more carefully to what means to have an asymptotic expansion. Okay. Asymptotic expansions are crucial in physics. I mean, in physics it's very hard to get convergent expansions, to get series which are convergent. And the next best thing you can get in physics, in quantum field theory in particular, are these asymptotic expansions. Okay. So you have to live with that, and the rules of asymptotic expansions are a little bit special, and in the exercises you will actually work out them a little bit. But let me just, for the moment, be in focus on this thing, which clearly has some relationship to this original integral, and let's see what we can say about this. Well, the first thing you can see is that this integral, it's part of the Gaussian integration, that it's really an average of a function. So let me now write then set H bar. So this sign, the meaning of this sign is an asymptotic expansion of this quantity here, so I have 1 over n factorial, and then I have minus h bar over 4 to the n, and then I have x for n. So I and using this this notation here, so let me actually remember that x for n. So in G, X for NG is actually, so let me actually call this that G. So when I put G means Gaussian theory. So this is this thing. So this is an average in the Gaussian theory. Actually here I'm putting H bar to 1. Okay, so this is 1, and here I have x to the 4, okay? So this is in the Gaussian theory when h bar is equal to 1 because I did this rescaling of h bar here, okay? But, you know, again, this is something that you can calculate. Mm-hmm. It's actually, so you can write this actually as square root of 2 pi I h bar. So let me write it like this. Ak to h bar to the k. So these coefficients can actually be evaluated. So this coefficient just keep track of this 4 of n factorial and of this thing here. This can be calculated very easily. And as I said, I'm going to give a more general framework to this calculation. But the important, and actually what you find, let me just write the result here. Okay, so this is this coefficient, and this, when k is large, grows like k factorial, okay? So let me summarize. When your theory is not Gaussian, when your theory has a non-trivial piece which is not Gaussian, you can calculate some of these quantities by doing asymptotic expansion. So the asymptotic expansion, the principle is very trivial. You just expand the piece which you cannot solve in power series, in formal power series. And then you get a formal power series representation of the quantity that you wanted to compute. And this is a power series in H bar. Remember, H bar is a small parameter, so this is a power series. And it turns out that the coefficients of this expansion grow factorially. Okay? So this series is definitely not convergent, has zero radius of convergence. Any series in which the coefficients grow factorially have zero radius of convergence. So in quantum theory, you typically never get convergent series. You will get at most asymptotic series. And this is a fact of life and you have to live with it. So most of the precision calculations that physicists do are based on asymptotic series. So we have to live with this. But so you see, we didn't know how to calculate this integral exactly, but we end up with some sort of precise asymptotic expansion in powers of h bar. Okay, and this is the method of perturbation theory. You cannot calculate things exactly, but you calculate them in a power series in a parameter which is small. Okay, and this is the crucial aspect of this calculation. Okay, so you see already that quantum theories become complicated. So here we have a very trivial action, and already with this trivial action, you get a non-trivial structure with a non-trivial power series, and as I said, in the exercise sessions, you will actually see in which sense this series is telling you information about this integral. I mean, at the end of the day, you have to understand that this integral is a number. Z of h bar is a function of h bar. It's a number. It's well defined for any real positive h bar. It's a number. You can compute it numerically. The question is how this number, this function of h bar, which is a number, it's encoded in this function here, in this asymptotic series here. This is another important question in quantum theory, because very often you are not able to solve the problem exactly. You have to solve it in perturbation theory. You will get an asymptotic series. And it's a very important question how this asymptotic series is related to my original quantity here. Okay? It's one of the crucial questions. So if you want to do quantum theory, you have to live with divergent series. You have to live with asymptotic series. And part of the mathematical work that one has to do within quantum theory is to make sense of this asymptotic series in a meaningful way. Okay? But for physicists, sometimes, you know, they don't even really worry so much. They just produce these series and hope that they will be able to get information out of it. Okay? So that's also part of the things that... Okay, so let's make a pause. It's already 10:10, so let's make 15 minutes of pause. Are there any questions on this?
Sorry, this is a K or N?
Oh, sorry, this is K. Yeah, this is K. So what I'm going to do, all this in a sense is an introduction. What I'm going to do in the next hour is to really make this much more precise and to formulate in terms of what is called Big's lemma, which is really a kind of very general statement about how to calculate things. But maybe the most important thing to mention is that, you see, in order to calculate this series, we eventually end up calculating averages in the Gaussian theory. Okay? So a theory which is not Gaussian, thanks to perturbation theory, can be evaluated by calculating averages in the Gaussian theory. So in a sense, these objects, averages in the Gaussian theory, are the building blocks of the most possibly general theory, which is a perturbation or a modification of the Gaussian. So even if this integral cannot be done, as long as you know how to do these integrals, you can write these asymptotic series. And this is the basics, this is the basis of perturbation theory in quantum theory. Okay? Okay, so are there questions on this? Very confused? Disoriented? No? Okay. So as I said, you know, most of this was in a sense a little bit of a motivation. So for those of you who like formal things, you know, now I will be a little bit more formal. So, but as I said, you know, the main idea of perturbation theory is that you have a polynomial theory which can be regarded as a perturbation of a Gaussian. You eventually can compute formal power series. So you can compute your partition function, for example, as a formal power series by using averages in the Gaussian theory. Okay, so essentially, you reduce everything to Gaussian. So we are going to now formulate this more general. No? So this is the. I know that some people. So what I did until now is actually the preliminaries. So now we start with the actual stuff. So correlation of functions. And Big's lemma. So I'm going to put myself in the setting in which my my quantum field theory in zero dimensions is made out of, you know, the fields are variables in RP, and I'm going to define a Gaussian action by, so let me write it like this. So A is a matrix. So this is the most general Gaussian theory I'm going to consider. So it's a quadratic form in X. So A is a positive definite matrix. So all its eigenvalues are strictly positive. If you consider, so the most general Gaussian theory has a partition function which is given by this. So this is a general version of this simple Gaussian theory that I wrote before. And you can calculate this by diagonalization. So you essentially write this as a, you diagonalize this matrix, so you are going to get a product of key Gaussian functions with an appropriate so here lambda p are the eigenvalues of this matrix, the positive eigenvalues of this matrix. And then, you know, this is a product. So you get this is a product of integrals, so this is RP, the integrals are always in RP. And then, you know, you get here 2 pi I h bar to the p halves divided by the square root of lambda 1 up to lambda p. And this is just 2 pi h bar to the p over 2 divided by the square root of the determinant of A, okay? So this is the most general Gaussian integral, more general case than what we did before, okay? But as I said, what we want to calculate now are the analogs of these things here. So what we want to calculate then are a very, very general quantity, which is this one. We want to calculate, so remember that here X has p indices, so I want to calculate this. So the x e to the minus 1 over 2 h bar x a x, and then here I have the product of an arbitrary monomial in the variables x, okay? So mu 1, mu 2, mu i's are indices in the set 1p, okay? So this is what I want to calculate, okay? Because if I know how to calculate this, in principle I can calculate asymptotic expansions for more complicated theories, okay? And this thing is the basic, the calculation of this thing is in a sense the basic ingredient in quantum theory, and goes by the lemma of, it's a lemma that we can prove. It's a lemma based on Gaussian integration. So Big's lemma tells you the following. Well, it has values. So I'm going to write it in three parts. The first thing that it says is that the if you have an odd number of variables, then its average is zero. The second tells me that if I have two variables, x mu and x nu, then this is going to be h bar, and then the mu nu entry of the inverse matrix of A. So A is a positive definite matrix with a non-zero determinant, it has an inverse, and this average is given by this. The more general thing is the answer to this, so when the number of variables is even, you can actually calculate them explicitly, and this is h to the n divided by 2 to the n, n factorial. N here is 2n, and then you have a sum over permutations of two variables. And then you have a minus 1 of mu sigma 1, mu sigma 2, tac tac, a minus 1, mu sigma 2n minus 1, mu sigma of 2n. So S to n is the permutation group of 2n variables. Sigma is an arbitrary permutation. And here the indices, you have essentially to take all these indices, put them in a row, okay? And then you sum over all possible permutations from 1 to 2n, okay? So here you will have tons of things, okay? So this is the Big's lemma, yes?
I'm just not sure for the first part, is it for the odd?
Yeah, yeah, sorry, I should have written this as 2n plus 1, yeah. 2n plus 1, yeah, sorry. Okay, so this is the basic thing. This is a general result for calculating averages in a Gaussian theory defined by this. So let's prove this theorem, this lemma. And the proof also is interesting because it introduces the idea of generating functionals, which is also a very crucial idea in quantum theory. Okay. So in order to prove this theorem, for this lemma, I'm going to introduce a function of J, where J is a vector of P components. So J is a vector of P components. This is a Gaussian. This is, in a sense, a variation of the partition function. So it's 1 over 2 h bar x a x. And I sum here from mu equal to 1 to p of g mu x mu, okay? So if j is equal to 0, so the first thing to notice is that if this vector is equal to 0, then this function is just the partition function of the Gaussian theory, okay? Very good.
Now, it's very easy to actually do this calculating this integral by Gaussian integration. Okay? Do you want me to do all the details? Or is it okay? Are you familiar with Gaussian integration? I mean, you just have to kind of complete the square. Yeah? And you have to change variables. So write this as a square. Okay? Well, okay, just, you know, I think it's easier to do it than, you know, than to tell you how you do it, okay? So this is the, let's write it in vector form. So the idea is to write this as 1 minus 2h of x minus b, a, x minus b, plus something, okay? Plus k. Okay, you want to write it in this way. Okay, so you have to complete the square. So you expand this, you get this is equal to minus 1 over 2 h bar, and then you will get here x, x, x. So a is symmetric, sorry, I should have made clear that this function is a symmetric. This is a symmetric matrix. I should actually add this here. So what I get here is plus b a x. Okay. And then the last term you have is plus minus minus 1 over 2 h bar. And then you have b a b. Okay. So you compare this to this, you see that in order to have this, you have that b times a. Yes?
What is a bar?
Sorry, a bar is just it's not there. Okay, sorry. So you have, when you compare both expressions, you compare
this expression with this, so this is this, and then you have to compare this with this, and then you see very clearly that J is actually 1 over H bar B A, okay? Or key transpose, okay? So maybe I should, okay, or yeah, so this is like this, okay? So that J is actually A times B divided by H bar, okay? So this tells you what is the value of J, and remember here I should have K. And then, you know, K is fixed by the fact that this would be zero, okay? So K is then 1 over 2 H bar, and then B, A, B. Well, from here it follows that B is H times A minus 1 J. So you just change variables here, and you will get H J transpose A minus 1 transpose A H A minus 1 J, and this gives you so you have 2 H bars, so you have H bar over 2 J T, and then there is 1 A minus 1, 2 A minus 1 and 1 A, so it gives you A minus 1 J. Okay. So, since you wrote, if you write this integral like this, so you write this integral like this, then you get that set J, you can actually already, this doesn't depend on X, yeah? So you can already put it outside, and then you get E to the H bar over 2, J transpose A minus 1 J. And then now you have an integral over dx of e to the minus 1 over 2 h bar x minus b transpose a x minus b. Okay, and you know, you are integrating over all of Rp, so this shift is completely irrelevant. So this is the integral of this is it, this is just z of h bar. Right, and this we know how to calculate it, so, and we also know that this is z of zero, so here to distinguish the argument in terms of j and the argument in terms of h bar, I put this square brackets, okay, not parentheses, so I can write this as z of zero, which is the partition, original partition function, times e to the h over 2 j Twiddle A minus 1 J, J transpose J, okay? So this quantity, again, since we are in a Gaussian theory, I can evaluate explicitly, okay? And I get this result, okay? Good? Now, why did I introduce this object? Well, generating functionals in quantum theory are very important because, as their name indicates, when you expand, so generating functionals typically depends on what is called a source. This thing is usually called a source. And they are interesting because when you do the expansion, the formal power series expansion in powers of J, you actually, the coefficients turn out to be the things that you want to calculate. And you probably have already done this because this trick I'm using is a standard trick in the theory of probability. Okay? I think I'm not an expert in probability theory, but I know that they do these kind of things and they even have some name for this. I think they call it maybe the characteristic function of the probability distribution. Hmm? So the characteristic function of the probability distribution is interesting because it's a generating function for all the averages of the variables. So here it's not any different. You just expand this around in power series of J. Well, you obtain the integral without J, which is z of zero. And then what you obtain? Well, You see, if you expand this exponential, you will get the exponential power series, and then you will get this thing to the power of m, but this thing to the power of m is just the sum of mu 1 up to the mu m from 1 to p of j mu 1 j mu m times x mu 1 x mu m. Okay? So the main property of this generating function is that, as I said, as you expand in powers of j, the numbers that you want to compute are just the coefficients of this. Okay? So you know that's a very good idea that people have used a lot in, for example, in combinatorics. Instead of calculating things one by one, you calculate a function such that the Taylor expansion of this function around the origin gives you a series whose coefficients are the numbers that you want to calculate. Okay? So instead of calculating a bunch of numbers, you calculate a function. And it turns out that calculating a function sometimes is much easier than calculating a bunch of numbers, but they contain the same information. Okay? So that's a very important idea. Now, in fact, as you see, just by expanding this Taylor series around the origin, I can read all these numbers, but I have computed a set of j, okay? I have computed this thing. So I can just read the numbers by expanding this thing in power series in j around the origin, okay? So let's do that. That's a very simple exercise to do this expansion. So let me now compare this then to this expansion here. So and now let me do the expansion of this object. Well, it's an exponential, so I can expand it in the same way. So let me expand n equals 0 to infinity. Now I have this prefactor, h bar over 2, so I will have h bar to the n, 2 to the n, n factorial, and then I have this product. But what is this product? Well, let me write it explicitly. This product is the product of mu nu equal 1 to p of j mu a minus 1 of mu nu j nu to the power of p. Okay? And this is set of 0, sum of n equals 0 to infinity, h bar to the n, 2 to the n, n factorial. And then here I will have the sum of mu 1 to m to n. And then I have g mu 1 papa g m to n. And then a minus 1 mu 1 mu 2. A minus 1, mu 2n minus 1, mu 2n. Okay? Is it okay? So I have computed this quantity in two different ways. This is just by expanding the definition, and this is by doing the Gaussian integration. But they are the same, okay? So this is not important, but now, you see, in both cases, what I got is a power series in the j's, okay, around the origin. Here the coefficients are what I want to calculate, and here the coefficients are already done. But before actually jumping to conclusions, I have to make sure that I don't get seduced by the indices, because the indices are always very seductive. I have to be very careful. And the reason is that this is a function, it's a totally symmetric function, in this change of all these coefficients. You agree with me, right? Right? So when you have a totally symmetric function in all these coefficients, in all its indices, it symmetrizes everything that it multiplies. So actually, this product, I have to be careful, because the product that comes from here is just the symmetrized product. So the way I have written these things, the only statements that I can deduce from here are statements about symmetrized coefficients, because these functions are symmetric. Okay? So when I take into account this, I write this finally at my in the final way. So I have the sum of n equals 0 to infinity, h to the n, 2 to the n, n factorial. And then I have the sum of j mu 1, j mu 2, n. And now I symmetrize this thing. Okay? Otherwise, the statement wouldn't be correct. Because, you know, essentially, everything which is non-symmetric is projected out by this symmetric function. Okay? So I have to then sum over, I have to symmetrize this. So symmetrize, what it means? Symmetrize means that I divide by the order of the symmetry group. And then I have to sum over all possible permutations. And then I get this A mu sigma 1, mu sigma 2, dot, 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 A minus 1 of mu sigma 2n minus 1, mu of sigma 2n. Okay? That's it. I'm done. Now we just equate the coefficients. Now what is the coefficient of this thing? Well, you can see that by equating, you will get immediately the answer. And tuck, tuck, tuck. So first of all, we notice that this mu m, so the only way that this is non-zero is that this is even. Here you only have even product, right? Products of an even number of j's. Okay? So if you have just an odd numbers of j's, this is zero. So this gives me my first statement. Well, the second statement is a particular case of the third, so we can just now collect. So now we know that m has to be even equal to 2n, okay? So m has to be 2n. 1 over 2n factorial is 1 over n factorial, and then just by equating, I just get this as the answer that I was looking for, okay? Very good. So here we are. That's what I wanted to prove, and this is statement 3. Okay? Now, this is a totally correct answer, but it's not very useful because when you do this calculation, I mean, summing over all the permutations is not a very clever thing to do, okay? So, and the reason is that when you sum over all these permutations, there are lots of there are lots of terms in the same which are equal. Okay. And the reason is the following. Now, if I do here, there is a lot of symmetry because I could exchange this. If you know this matrix is symmetric, okay. So if I exchange two indices, okay, I get this end result, okay. So, for example, if you do let's do the case n equal 2, okay? So this means that x mu 1, x mu 4 is equal to h squared divided by 4. Let me write it like this, 2 to the 2 times 2 factorial. And then here what you will have, we will have a minus 1 of mu 1, mu 2, a minus 1 of mu 3, mu 4, and then all the possible permutations. But you see, there are permutations that give me just the same thing. If I exchange mu 2 with mu 1 with mu 2, I get a mu 2 mu 1, a minus 1 of m 3 m 4, but I also get the term with a minus 1 mu 2 mu 1, a minus 1 mu 4 mu 3, and so on. So you see, many of these terms are completely equal, and it's very redundant, this sum. Another thing is that I will get another term here, which is a minus 1 mu 3 mu 4, a minus 1 mu 1 mu 2. So So this is another of the terms that I get here. So you see that this sum has a lot of symmetries, which is that if you, you know, when you write this sum, you have to really put the index in a row and then do all possible 4 factorial permutations. But you see that there are many permutations that give me the same term. And what are these permutations? These are permutations which are which involve permuting the indices inside the matrix A, okay? And there are permutations which involve changing the orders of the blocks of permutations. For example, mu1, mu2, mu3, mu4 is the identity permutation. And mu3, mu4, mu1, mu2, which is not an identity permutation, give you the same answer because from the point of view of the matrix, it's just exchanging the product of these two things. Okay? So there are many permutations. So let me now give a definition. So you see that there are many permutations there, which this already tells you that if you are a mathematician, you realize that permutation is not the right concept to organize this sum, okay? Because many permutations are completely redundant, okay? So permutation is not So one way to solve this, if you are a mathematician, is to introduce a notion of equivalence. So two permutations sigma prime in S to N are called weak equivalent if they give the same term in Big's lemma. So this means, for example, that this means, for example, here. So here you have the permutation, the identity permutation. So for example, mu3, mu4. Mu1, mu2 is equivalent to the identity. Is weak equivalent to the identity. Okay? In the same way, mu2, mu1, mu3, mu4 is equivalent to the identity. So you see, by looking at these terms, you can see that these two permutations are equivalent. They give you the same term in the permutation, and these two permutations are. These two permutations are equivalent, and so on. So you can define. So there is a notion of equivalence at some. So when you have equivalences, what is important is to have a notion of the equivalence class. And the equivalence class of permutations defined by this is called a pairing. We will call a pairing an equivalent class of permutations. Okay. So how many pairings are there in the set of 2n factorial permutations? Well, so how many pairings there are? Well, this is a kind of easy combinatorial question. So we have 2n factorial. But you can see how do we generate the equivalences? First of all, every time that we permute two of the matrix indices inside the, in general, there are n matrices, okay? So I can permute these two indices, I can permute these two indices here, blah, blah, up to the very end. So by permuting, so there are these permutations which are equivalent from permuting the indices in the matrices. On the other hand, by permuting the order of the matrices in the product, I also get the same permutation. For example, remember, mu3, mu4, and mu1, mu2, this permutation, mu3, mu4, mu1, mu2, was equivalent to mu1, mu2, mu3, mu4, and this is because I take this guy, I permute it with the other one, okay? And how many are out of this? Well, in general, there are n terms in this product, right? So there is an n factorial thing here. So actually, you see there are very few pairings. So actually there are, you know, so all these things give you identical thing. So this is the number of pairings is this. And this is very nice because this is precisely the same factor that we have here, 2 to the n times n factorial. This is precisely, this number counts the number of redundancies given by this. So this is the this is the number of elements in each equivalence class. Okay? So the total number of equivalence classes is the total number of elements, of permutations in this case, of 2n elements, divided by the total number of elements in each equivalence class. Each equivalence class has the same number of elements. Okay? So, for example, here, you see that it's very useful to introduce the notion of pairing because there are 4 factorial here, in this case n equal 2, there are 4 factorial permutations. But there are only 3 pairings. Okay, just 4 factorial divided by 2. To the 2 divided by 2. Okay, this is 3. Okay, so now let me write this as a sum of pairings. So that's the natural thing to do now. So I got this answer, but as I said, this answer is a little bit redundant. So let's denote a pairing. P is a pairing, and this is a pairing is also a permutation. It's a equivalence class of permutations, so I can choose any of these representatives here. So in particular, a pairing is you can write it as a permutation. So I'm going to write it like this: p1, p2n. So here, if I sum over pairings, this factor will disappear, and then I have p as sum over pairings, and then I get a minus 1 mu p1 p2, sorry, mu p1 mu p2 a minus 1 mu of p2 n minus 1 mu of p2 n. So this is the final form of the Leakes theorem, in which now I'm summing over pairings. And as I said, it's very important because, you know, it's not the same thing to do 24 numbers than summing 3, right? So 4 factorial is 24 and 3 is just 3. Yes?
I have some physics questions.
Yes?
So we wrote the action as x, a, x.
Yes.
And then we have to allow a to include derivative operators to
no, but here, yeah.
Terms.
Yeah. But this is what will happen in more than 0 dimensions. But remember, we are in 0 dimensions, okay? Okay. So here we are not going to deal with that. When I said the formal structure of what is going on would translate to the setting that you are mentioning, because it's true that, for example, we have kinetic operators. This means that A is not going to be just a matrix. It's going to be an operator, acting on the appropriate space of actions. And A minus 1, which is the inverse of a matrix, will be understood as an inverse operator. Okay? So formally, if you change X by fields and A by operators, everything I'm doing here could be applied to any quantum field theory.
And then Wick's lemma is a statement about free field theories.
Exactly. It's a statement about correlation functions in free field theories. So this formula applies to any quantum field theory with the proviso that A minus 1 has to be understood as an operator. But it's exactly the same thing, okay? That's the nice thing about this, is that it's really a theorem that people use a lot in quantum field theory, but its basic bones are here already in the space of functions, where you don't have to worry so operators are matrices and so on, okay? But for the moment being, I'm just working in 0 dimensions, so there are no operators, there are matrices, and there are no fields, but there are variables, okay? Any other question? Okay, so let me actually let's do an example of this. Let's calculate, for example, the four-point function, so the correlation function of a product of four variables using Big's lemma. Because this is, in a sense, one of the most, probably the simplest example of this. So we want to calculate, I already showed you how this goes, but let's do it here. So what is Big's lemma? It tells me that this is going to be h to the square. And now I have to do pairings, okay? So pairings, what is the, well, the first thing that you get is the identity. Okay? And now it's easy to see that here the next pairing will be mu 1, mu 3. mu 2 mu 4, and the last one is a minus 1 mu 1 mu 4 times a minus 1 mu 2 mu 3. So you see, from all these 24 permutations that in principle I would have to compute, pairings only reduce to 3, okay? There is another way of writing this, because remember that the inverse, the basic building block of Big's lemma are just products of inverses of matrices, okay? The entries of the inverse matrix. So this is also, you can express it less of this, so I can write this, and you know, this is probably closer to the kind of thing that you would find in you know, on this, so you would get, you would write it in terms of products of okay? So this is this means that this average of four variables can be expressed in terms of sums of products of two variables. So the building block is always what physicists call sometimes this the two-point function or the correlation function of two pairs and so on. Now there is a very useful graphical rule for pairings, which also like practical. People use a lot in practical calculations. I mean, Big's lemma is used also in many branches of mathematics. Every time you have to do with something like free fields, you have to do something like Big's lemma. So, for example, people working with, vertex algebras and things like that, they also have to use things like this. So, the way you think about the pairings, it's very simple. So, pairing, also I introduced it in this formal way of equivalence class of permutation and so on. Pairing is actually pairing. You make pairs out of things, okay? So in order to write this, it's very useful to use a graphical thing. So this term here, sometimes people write it like this, in the sense that I make these two pairs, out of these four, I make these two pairings. So this gives me the first one. Now, the second one would be the pairing in which I join these things and these things. So this would be the second pairing I have here. And the third pairing would be when I pair the first and the last one, and then I do this thing here. Okay, so that would be this and this. Okay, so that would be the three pairings that you do. Okay. Now, you see this language of this Big's lemma is very important, because once you know this, you can do Feynman diagrams. And we will do Feynman diagrams very soon. Okay, we will actually use the Big's lemma to do Feynman diagrams. So essentially, once you know this, you know almost as much as any quantum field theories. The only thing is that you have to go to infinite dimensions instead of finite dimensions, but that's easy. That's easy. Okay. Other questions on this? So this is our basic technical tool to do perturbation theory, okay? And this is like I see, but as I said, At this stage, this is just a statement about Gaussian integrals, about averaging Gaussian integrals. But I guess, you know, I mean, for people who know quantum field theory, you know, once you know this basic structure, then going to quantum mechanics or quantum field theory should be relatively easy, okay? At least from the point of view of that formal structure. Of course, there are other problems. Dealing with operators is not the same thing as dealing with matrices, you know? Otherwise, you know, function analysis would be just a chapter of algebra, and it's not, right? So there are many other complications, but this formal structure of this, the combinatorial structure will be always the same for any theory in which we decide to evaluate things by perturbing around the Gaussian structure, okay? So this is how what happens when you do perturbations around the Gaussian structure, okay? Are there questions, comments, complaints? So what time is it? It's already 11, 10? Okay, so let's do a last break and then I will continue in the next hour, okay? Okay, so in the last half an hour today, I'm going then to introduce Feynman diagrams. So you see, this is already quite fast. Huh? We already, you know, we started with trivial things and we're already doing Feynman diagrams. Most of physicists take years to get to this point, but that's the good thing of being an advanced course. You know, Dror Bar-Natan, who is going to be your, I think he's going to give a course, has a fantastic seminar title. You know Stonehenge, this megalithic thing in Britain? So the title of the talk was From Stonehenge to Witten, Skipping All Details. Okay. I love this talk. So so this is a little bit like this. You know, this course is a little bit like this. From functions to Feynman diagrams, skipping all details. And the course is going to be also a little bit like this. Okay. So then point three done. Then Feynman diagrams, perturbation theory, and Feynman diagrams. Again, in real life, in quotation marks, this is slightly more complicated, but the important thing is that the combinatorial structures are very similar, so you should be able to do things like this. So we are going to use the same setting as in proofs of Big's theorem, so my axiom functional, so remember that x is a variable in RP. My axiom will be a Gaussian axiom of the form that I wrote before, so it will have half of x, you know, defined by a symmetric positive definite matrix. And now I'm going to introduce a parameter lambda, and I will call this the interacting part. So this I is for interacting, okay? So this could be, for example, an example of this would be something like this, right? X hat x. And then I could have here, which is actually an example that we will do, plus mu1, if you want to write a generic quartic theory, which depends on x to the fourth, but now we have, since we have many variables, we will introduce sort of tensor. So this is an example that we will look at in detail. Okay. And since I want to make my life simpler, I will assume that this tensor is completely symmetric in its indices, okay? So this is, you want, this is a quadratic form, this is a quartic form, no? If you want, some sort of given a vector, and this gives me a real number, I write it in components, okay? Very good. So here, lambda is already included in G. So lambda is a parameter, but it's included in G. G is a number. G. So for each choice of indices, G is a number. So you can we can assume that G is small in some sense, or that, or you can introduce a explicit lambda. This is not going to be important. Okay. Very good. So now we want to calculate the partition function. So the partition function now. So if you introduce this lambda, is going to be given by this function. So let me write it like this. I'm not going to use h bar. I'm going to use lambda. It's a little bit the same because remember, in many cases you can put, you can remove by a change of variables. You can remove the 1/h bar and put it in the interaction term. So lambda will be included in h bar will be included in lambda in some appropriate way. But in any case, I want to calculate something like this. Okay, and then what we do. So this is the kind of quantity that you would like to compute, a partition function for this non-trivial theory. So it has a Gaussian piece. Yeah? So it was Gaussian, we know how to do. But we have also this piece here. So the way we proceed, again, we are not going to get something equal, but we are going to hopefully get an asymptotic series in lambda. Okay. So what I do is I span, so I keep this Gaussian piece in the exponent, and now I take this thing, so I get xi to the n. Okay, times minus lambda n divided by n factorial. Okay. So you see that when you do this procedure, what we get is a formal power series in lambda. When I say formal, I mean that this is not necessarily a convergent series, okay? So it's a formal power series in lambda, okay? And each coefficient of this series is obtained, well, the trivial piece comes from the n factorial, but it comes from evaluating this thing. But this is evaluating something in the with the Gaussian measure. So if this xi of x is polynomial, we can evaluate all terms here, in principle, when n is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on, using Wieck's lemma. Okay? So we'll apply Wieck's lemma to all this, and I'm going to write this as z0, so the z when lambda is equal to 0, times s the sum from 0 to infinity, minus lambda to the n divided by n factorial. And then this is the average of this function to the power of n. Okay? So, and this is the kind of average that we can compute if si is polynomial. Huh? If si is non-polynomial, then, you know, it might be more delicate. You can compute this by using Wieck's lemma. So this is the general framework for perturbation theory. Okay? So we start with a theory whose action is not Gaussian. But so this part here we don't really know what to do. We cannot compute this integral exactly very often, but we can always do perturbation theory. We span thin lambda and we hope for the best. Okay. Now what means we hope for the best? This is something that you will clarify in the exercises, and I think this is still a place where mathematicians can make a lot of contributions to quantum field theory. But in any case, this is what you have to do. I mean, all calculations done at CERN, I mean, all calculations done in order to understand the experiments at CERN are based on this scheme. Okay, so of course, you know, you have to make sure that. In real life, you have to make sure that lambda is sufficiently small so that computing the very first terms in this series is already enough to understand what is going on. Okay, but that's another issue. Again, as mathematicians, we can indulge in the luxury of saying that we want to understand the formal properties of this formal power series. Okay, very good. Now, I don't want to develop this kind of in full generality. Doesn't make any sense. So what I'm going to do is to take this example. So I want to work out how these rules work in this example. So my example is going to be the quartic, so the general quartic theory. The general quartic theory then, so what I have to compute are these quantities here. So g mu 1, mu 4,
x mu 1, x mu 4 to the n. Okay? So I have to compute this with Big's lemma. Okay, so let's see. So you see, perturbation theory is something which it's nice because it's systematic. So you can start with n equal 1, then you go to n equal 2, then you go to n equal 3. At some point, cannot go. You see that the complexity of the calculations becomes very big. Huh? But in principle, it's something that you can do systematically. So for example, for n equal 1, it's something that it's already, g is a number. So for g equal 1, what you have to do is to calculate this. OK, and this is something that we did before. So I'm not going to repeat it. Well, maybe I should repeat it, sorry. So remember that we got a minus 1 mu 1, mu 2, a minus 1, mu 3, mu 4, plus two other pairings. But since this thing is totally symmetric, it symmetrizes all the indices, so essentially everything that comes here is going to be identical to what comes here. I'm using Einstein's conventions. Sorry, I forgot to tell you. Here and here. I'm using Einstein's conventions, which says that repeated indices are summed over. Here I'm summing over all m1 to m4, to all possible values. Remember that each of these indices runs from 1 to p. So here I use the sum. Here I didn't put it, but in this part of the course, when I don't... If indices are repeated, this means that they have to be summed over, okay? So here there are sums, okay? So all these things are sums. And precisely, since these are sums, you are multiplying this tensorial structure with something which is fully symmetric, so you can see that these guys are going to be equal because you can always change. These labels are silent, like they don't have any personality, you can always exchange them. So what you get is 3, which is the total number of pairings, g, mu 1, mu 4, and then you get a minus 1, mu 1, mu 2, a minus 1, mu 3, mu 4, okay? So this is the first calculation. This will give you the first term in this series, okay? The first term we see will be this thing there. And again, I insist that indices are summed over. So life becomes more interesting when n is equal to 2. So when n is equal to 2, you have to calculate g, mu 1, mu 4, g, mu 1, mu 4, and then you have to calculate x, m 1, x, m 4, x, mu 1, x, mu 4. Okay? So at this point, many people decide that they... physics is not what they want to do in life. And, you know, algebra and geometry is probably better. But some still, the survivors keep doing this calculation. And then, you know, if you want to keep doing this calculation, then you have to, it's good to introduce a kind of good method. Okay, sometimes there are things that are invented which are not deep, but that are incredibly useful. Okay. So the thing that was invented in order to do this kind of calculation is what is called a Feynman diagram, okay? So in order that we can organize this calculation systematically, you invent Feynman diagrams, okay? So what are Feynman diagrams? Well, Feynman diagrams are ways of representing graphically the pairings appearing in Big's lemma. This is just what it is, okay? It's not something deep. It's just, you see here, remember, we will have to do all these pairings, right? We have to pair X, this one, with some of these here, so there are many combinatorial possibilities. So what Feynman invented was a graphical way of doing this, okay? So in terms of doing things purely algebraically, you do it graphically. I have to say that it's always good. I mean, I'm not a super expert on Feynman diagrams, but I had done calculations of many of them.
And it's also good to keep the algebraic part in mind, okay? I mean, there are people who probably have computed so many of these things that they are able to do the diagrams directly. But I always find useful from time to time to go back to the original pairing algebraic structure because it's also good. So how do you do these calculations of Feynman diagrams? Well, so the idea is the following. Here, the basic object is what appears in the interaction term, right? Remember, there are four x's here, okay? Okay, these are four x's. And when you do n equal 2, you have to take the square of this. So you will have two groups of four x's. And if you do n equal 3, you will have to have three groups of four x's, okay? So since this group of four x's, it's very important, we are going to call him, we are going to give him a name, and this name is called vertex, okay? Or interaction vertex. So you see, we are already doing quantum field theory, essentially, because this is the terminology of quantum field theory. So a vertex means that, remember that we want to do pairings, okay? So in order to do this, to do the pairings, the vertex we are going to put for each group of four variables here, we are going to put a dot. And from this dot, there are going to be four legs coming. Okay? So this represents x mu 1, x mu 4. Sometimes you might even want to add labels. You see, sometimes these x's have labels because they have mu 1 or mu 4. So sometimes you might even want to put labels here. The order in which you put them is irrelevant because this is a commuting product, okay? But here is not going to be completely necessary, okay? So imagine that you want, so if there is only one group of four in the calculation that I want to do, we are going to just write one single vertex, okay? So for n equal 1, you will have just one vertex. So this is n equal 1. Now you want to do n equal 2, we will do it later, we will have to do two vertices, okay? Two vertices like this, okay? It's okay? Are you with me? Great. So what do we do? Let's do n equal 1 first. So what do we do? Remember that when you have to do this equation, what you have to do are pairings, okay? So pairings are joining together two of these things, two of these variables. But now variables are represented by legs. So pairings are now going to be given by joining legs. So for example, let's do it carefully the first time. So let's assume that, let's put the labels just for the moment being. So remember that there was a pairing in which you put x mu 1 with x mu 2 and x mu 3 with x mu 4, okay? So putting these things together means that you are going to join the legs, and then you join the legs, and then you have this thing here. These two legs are joined, and these two legs are joined. Okay? And this is your first Feynman diagram, okay? Now, you could now join, remember that there are three choices of pairings. Now, another nice thing of the Feynman diagram is obvious that you have to do pairings of two variables. So, there is another possibility, which is to join this thing with this thing. So you would get this thing here and this thing here, okay? And finally, you could join this mu 1 with mu 4, so you would get something like this. Okay, so mu 1 joins with mu 4 and then mu 2, okay? So that would be mu 1 joining with mu 2, that would be mu 1 joining with mu 4, and so on, okay? So we get three Feynman diagrams, which correspond to the three possible pairings. And in this case, since this is multiplying a totally symmetric indexes, you see that these three diagrams give you the same contribution, okay? Because, the indexes here, this thing is totally symmetric, so the indices are really relevant at the end of the day. Okay, And actually, you see this in the topology of these diagrams. These diagrams are topologically equivalent, right? I mean, they have the same form of two circles joined by a point, okay? So this just gives you three times this Feynman diagram. And that's the calculation I have here. Now, in order to finish the calculation of the Feynman diagram, for each lines that you join together, you have to put an inverse power of a minus 1. So here are two lines that came together, another two lines that came together. So here you will need a minus 1, mu 1, mu 2. And here you will need a minus 1, mu 3, mu 4. And then, you know, you have to multiply everything together by mu 4 with a factor of 3. So this diagram gives you this thing here, OK? So the rules for Feynman diagrams are that, sometimes people write them like this. For each vertex, you will have a factor of g mu 1, mu 4, okay? And then for each line that joins, appears inside this diagram, you are going to have a minus 1 of mu, mu. So it's good to label here. And then, you know, if you have a line joining an index mu with an index nu, you will have a minus 1 mu nu. So these are what are called the Feynman rules. And you see, they are made of what is called a vertex, and this is sometimes is called a propagator. But again, these are just names. In quantum field theory, they have a more precise meaning. But here, we are just actually doing calculations of averages in a Gaussian probability distribution. Okay. 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 So this is how it works. So now let's try to do the calculation for n equal 2. Okay. I'm not going to be able to finish in 10 minutes, but maybe I can just set the stage. So you see, once you, the first thing I want to say is that the Feynman diagrams is like bicycling. I mean, you just, you know, you can't think about the bicycle as a dynamical object, apply Newton's law and so on. But you know, when you jump on the bicycle, either you fall or you don't. Okay, so you don't really learn to run a bicycle by theoretical contemplation. So the best way to learn in Feynman diagrams is just by doing them. Okay, it's just you know, so. So for those of you who have like a more abstract leanings, you know, this is maybe not the biggest pleasure of all, but for those of you who like to do like, these are like little toys, right? I mean, this is a way of prolonging your childhood, you know. You know, instead of playing with Lego, you play with Feynman diagrams, and then, you know, afternoons are more fun, right, in this way. So the main goal is to really enjoy doing this calculation. So how would you do now n equal 2? Well, now, remember, you will have two vertices, and you have to think about all possible ways in which you can join these legs, okay? So it's like a dating online, you know, you have all these things, and you have to make all possible couples, you know, appearing in this drawing, right? So the first thing you notice is that there are like two different vertices, and then you can have two different types of diagrams. You can either join one leg of one vertices with the other, okay? Or you just can decide that these legs are only going to talk among themselves, okay? So for example, you could have a diagram like this, which would be just two copies of what we had before. Or you could say, no, I want that one leg here joins the other vertex here. So you could have something like, for example, this thing here. Okay, so you see, when n equal 2, there is this choice. When n equal 1, there was only one vertex, so the only possibility was to join the lines which were inside each of the vertices, okay, inside the same vertex. But now when you have two vertices, you have two different choices. Either you just keep these vertices apart, they don't talk to each other, and the lines just, you know, the only lines that you join belong to the same vertex, or you are able to join lines, you join lines that you join lines that belong to different vertices. Now it's clear that these two things are very different. And actually this has a name. This diagram is clear that you can divide it by in two pieces without cutting a line, right? While this diagram you cannot really divide it in two pieces, right? I mean it's just one single object. So this diagram is called disconnected. And this diagram is called connected. So starting with n equal 2, you see that there are two types of diagrams, connected and disconnected. And for one reason that I want to make explicit very quickly, very soon, the most important diagrams are the connected diagrams. Why? Because essentially disconnected diagrams can be obtained by some sort of doing what you did before. Okay? These two diagrams are not new, you see. These diagrams you already saw when you did n equal 1. When you did n equal 1, you saw this diagram. So these diagrams are just copies. You have two copies of what you already have in n equal 1. But it's not really a new diagram that appears when you have more vertices, right? So there is a kind of precise statement of what this means, and I will make that more precise. But for the moment, let me focus on the connected diagram. Okay. So let's forget about the disconnected diagram. So connected diagrams are the diagrams that you are forced to join the legs. So it's very easy to see that there are only two types of connected diagrams in n equal 2. Okay. So now it's a question of finding all possible topologies of diagrams that contribute at n equal 2. So this is one. So what would be the other one? Any volunteer? Yes?
Like if you also connect the other pairs of legs between the diagrams.
Absolutely. So you see here, I only connected two of the legs of the diagram, but there were still some legs that were only talking to legs inside the same diagram. But I can now decide that all four legs are going to join the others, and then I would get something like this. Okay? Okay? So that's exactly, thank you. So these are the two possibilities. These are the only two possible diagrams. The only two possible connected diagrams for n equal 2. Okay? So the topology is clear. There are only these two diagrams. Now, what is very important is that the number of ways in which you can construct these diagrams is very crucial. Remember that when n equal 1, there were three possible ways of getting the same diagram, right? So here, it's obvious that, for example, this diagram can be made in many possible ways. Because remember that these legs have names. These legs are not completely impersonal. They have some personality. So it's not the same thing that this person joins this, that this person joins this. These are two different possibilities. So it's clear that for each of these diagrams, you have different possibilities, okay? So this is the easier one, right? Because this is easy. How many possibilities have to have this diagram? Think about this diagram. You have four legs here. You have four legs there, and you have to connect them in all possible ways. One with each other. So what are the possibilities? Yeah, but what is this like more? Yeah. Yes, this is 4 factorial, okay? So these are all the possible permutations of these 4 legs. Every time you permute the legs, you will get a different thing. So this thing actually has 4 factorial terms, 4 factorial pairings. There are 4 factorial pairings that give you the same diagram. Okay? And that's very important because it's not enough to get, in order to really compute these pairings, you have to, I mean, remember that these diagrams are just ways of encoding pairings. So if many pairings give me the same diagram, you have to mark it. You have to really make sure that you count them. Okay. Now this is slightly more tricky, okay, but it's not so complicated because here, you see, the key thing here is that in each of these diagrams, you will choose 2 lines to join with the other. So how many possibilities are of choosing 2 lines out of 4?
6.
Very good.
So I can choose six lines here. I can choose six lines here, okay? And then I join them. How many possibilities are of joining the two lines that I have chosen? Sorry? No, no, no. Once I have chosen two lines here, and once I have chosen two lines here, how many possibilities are of joining them together? Only two. Just here or just permute. So here are two. So for this joining here, there are two possibilities. And then the lines that are left only have one possibility. Okay? So this, the total number of possibilities for this diagram is 72. Okay. Great. So you see that, so now what will be the contributions of these diagrams to the pairing? So remember that we are computing this sort of pairing. And then if you just take into account these diagrams, we see that we get 4 factorial times this thing plus 72 times this thing. And actually, remember the rules. This is going to be, this is not really an equality. These are the diagrams that appear in these calculations. So the rules tell you that here you have 2 vertices. So you will have mu1, mu4. And then you will get here a minus 1, mu1, mu1. A minus 1, mu 4, mu 4. Because you remember, these lines have mu indexes, mu 1, mu 2, up to mu 4. And these lines have mu indexes, mu 3, up to mu 4. Okay? So you get exactly this. But for the other one, you get 72. You get g mu 1, mu 4, g mu 1, mu 4. And then what you get here is the following. You get here are 2 lines that you join together of the mu indices, so you will get a minus 1, mu 1, mu 2. There are 2 lines that you join here for the new indices, so you get a minus 1, mu 1, mu 2. And then you get 2 lines which join the mu and the new indices, so you will get a minus 1, mu 1, sorry, mu 3, say, mu 3, a minus 1, mu 4, mu 4. Okay, so these are the contributions that you get from these diagrams to this pairing, okay? To this full pairing, okay? Okay. But these are just the connected diagrams. So there will be also the contributions from the disconnected diagrams. But already from the connected diagrams you get these contributions, okay? Is this clear? So you see, it's a very funny thing, you know, it has all the nice ingredients, combinatorics. And you see, you can imagine that this gets incredibly complicated as you go to higher values of n. You now do n equal 3, then it's a little bit more messy, right? You have 3 vertices, you have to start like, first of all, you have to find all the possible topologies of diagrams. And for each topology, you have to count the number of pairings that appear, okay? These sometimes are called, it's not exactly defined this way, but it's called sometimes symmetry factors of the diagrams because this number of pairings are related to the symmetry of these diagrams. For example, this diagram is clearly has this kind of permutation symmetry of the 4 legs, okay? Well, this one has only a permutation symmetry of these 2 legs, okay? And so on. So there are different symmetries in the diagrams, and then this will give you different types of pairings and so on. So you see, it's a complicated business. And as the number n grows and grows, your ability to do this calculation becomes smaller. And eventually, even with the help of computers, you reach a limit. You reach a limit in which you cannot really compute anymore. That's why, you know, in actual quantum field theory, people like to push these calculations to very large orders, to very large orders in the number of vertices. So for example, the QCD, which is the theory of quantum chromodynamics, which describes interaction between quarks and gluons inside the nucleons. It was really an achievement when they got to n equal 5. You know, for some calculations, they were able to go to 5 vertices, okay?
And this was really, or even, you know, even less, probably four vertices. Okay, so and this has, you know, QCD was in, discovered in the 1970s. Okay, and now, you know, like 50 years later, we are only being able to do the calculation up to order 5. So you see, this is really very, very complicated. So just it's a combinatorial problem, but even with the help of computers, the combinatorial complexity of the problem increases in a really tremendous way. Okay? So most of the things that you, most of the calculations that are done in physics are really very much limited by this combinatorial problem. Okay? So this is also one area in which you know, newer mathematical ideas might be very helpful, and so on. Okay, but okay, I think now it's 12 and we have all to leave. There is time for a quick question. Yes?
Yeah, I'm just not sure where does the symmetry come from that allows you to sum up all the corresponding diagrams. Because I'm just not sure how the terms in A minus 1 do not change. For example, one swaps mu1, v1, u2, v2 for mu1, v2, mu2, v1.
But you see, this tensor is completely symmetric, right? This is my assumption. And I'm summing over all the indices. So imagine that I change mu1 with mu2 here. That will give you something
else. This is still in Einstein summation convention. I was just not getting, I was just not thinking of the whole expression as being summed. So, yeah.
No. Once you remember, here I'm using Einstein's convention, all repeated indices are summed. Mm-hmm. Of course, if they are not summed, you are completely right. If you are not summed, then, you know, I would have much more many indices, okay? But once they are summed, this is simple, okay? Okay.